If you're a Star Wars fan, one of the most beautiful moments in the whole movie series was the sunset right outside of the Skywalker residence in Tatooine. Having a curious mind like we do, surely you have thought, is this scenario possible? Is it possible to stand on a planet where I would stare at a sunset with twin stars? Hold on to your seats as we solve this question in today's episode. The Skywalker's estate is located on a planet named Tatooine, which according to the Star Wars fandom wiki belongs to the Tatoo stellar system. This is very unique due to the characteristics of its center. It revolves around what we call a binary star. A binary star is a small star system orbiting about a common center of mass, or what's more properly called their barycenter. If you think this is absolutely ridiculous, you would be more astonished that the recent understanding states that there could be more than two stars revolving around a common barycenter, which is of course surprising, especially we know stars exert gravitational force. So someone could easily think, wouldn't the two stars affect each other gravitationally and collide with one another eventually? Well, you don't have to look far to get an answer to that. Our very own planet orbits around the Sun, but practically we're not colliding with it, aren't we? This is due to the appropriate combination of all the factoring forces, i.e. gravity, angular momentum, orbiting speed, and this event doesn't happen at least as far as we humans are alive. Applying this to binary star systems, the stars are in positions where in the strength of their forces of influence towards one another is just enough to keep them in place. Of course, theoretically speaking, collisions can still happen, but as far as the general understanding goes, the chances of this happening is extremely small. Back before, astronomers thought that star systems were mostly singular. We couldn't blame them since our very own solar system is a single star system, so naturally one would think maybe all the other stars are the same. Thankfully, William Herschel found out otherwise. In the 18th century, Herschel was cataloging as many stars as he could when he found out that stars couldn't just be singular, but also move in pairs, such as the binary stars. Later on, it was established that binary or even multiple star systems are much more prevalent in the universe than what is previously thought. How common is a multiple star system, you ask? Recent statistics predict that the case might be that up to 85% of the stars are binary systems. If you put this to the perspective of human population, our universe is basically a country where up to 8.5 people could possibly be twins. Talk about seeing double all the time. To make things even more strange, astronomers were also puzzled how binary stars even have planets revolving around them. In theory, the tug of war between the two star system should have a range of results varying from eccentric orbits up to planets being ejected and quite possibly crash with other stars. Moreover, to convince you of how big a deal this actually is, let's just say I would reveal an almost binary star system later in this episode. Can you guess which star it is? Keep watching to find out. So how do they actually form? Well, if you recall, our sun's birth involved a swirling cloud of dust and gas with an extremely massive and extremely energetic center, which sooner or later settled down to form the solar system. Binaries have the same story. They too have started from a cloud of dust or nebula. However, instead of settling to just one star, the particles coalesced to two or more. That's about it. Scientists didn't really find anything particular yet to what conditions would give birth to specifically just binaries. Let's look into the types of binary stars, shall we? The first type is the optical double stars. These are stars that cannot be really categorically described to be binary, since in reality they are not. It's just that if we look at them hard enough, the degree of separation between the two is really difficult to distinguish, leading to the misjudgment of taking them to be binary stars. One example of this is Alpha 1 and Alpha 2 from the Capricorn constellation. Upon investigation via telescope, these two stars really appear to be very, very close to one another. So how do we distinguish optical doubles from actual binaries? Earlier we stated that binary stars move in a common barycenter, so if an observed star is actually a binary, then observing how two stars move with respect to one another must give the information we need to verify. A simple if-then solution, but quite ingenious, isn't it? Okay, how about we move to the category of actual binary stars? To have the first example, we don't have to go so far, because the closest star to Earth, after Sun of course, Alpha Centauri, is actually a visual binary star composed of two smaller stars called Alpha Centauri A and B. Moreover, the Skywalkers and practically all the residents of Tatooine would all agree that their star system is a visual binary. That is, of course, assuming they are using the same cataloging system as us here. The definition of a visual binary is fairly simple. If you can observe it via the telescope or even by the naked eye, and you can distinguish them as two separate stars, then you can categorize it as a binary. But one would think, can't we practically already see almost all of the stars at this point? Sadly, we're not there yet, with the current limitation of technology. But isn't it something awesome to look forward to? I, for one, am very excited. There are times when it is difficult to distinguish one star from the other, and at certain times, one of the two may appear along our line of sight upon observation because of how far they are from us. So when this happens, how do we know if this star is a binary? Well, if we are observing it from the side of the plane of orbit, and we are suspecting the star to be binary, then we expect to see some kind of wobbling back and forth, if the star is actually binary. Just to put it on a simpler perspective, let's say for instance you are standing on a chair and a ceiling fan is along your line of sight, and say at the edge of one of the blades is a bright red tape. When the fan is turned on, you would expect to see the red tape go left and right, wouldn't you? That's sort of the same concept applied to the observation of the wobble. We know the stars would undergo periodic motion, so we measure the consequences of the orbital motion. A binary star observed using this technique is called an astrometric binary. I wish we could say that the categorization ends there, but we still have a few more to cover. I hope you're still excited. How about we take the categorization difficulty another tier higher? Say we have a binary star that is myriads of kilometers away, so far that we can't make out by observation whether it's wobbling or not. What do we do then? At times like this, we'll rely on the nature of light being emitted by a star to help our investigation. For instance, let's say we have a binary star composed of two stars named Twinkle and Shine, that of which the former is larger than the latter. Upon our initial observation, Shine is at the front of Twinkle, so initially we thought this is a solo star. To validate whether this star system is a binary or not, we can observe its brightness. But how exactly is that going to be useful? When both Twinkle and Shine can be observed at the same time, we expect some amount of measurable brightness. We take note of this as the star's average brightness. Now, when Twinkle goes behind Shine, and since we know the former is bigger than the latter, and we measure the brightness, we will expect to see a great dip in its average brightness. If the other way around occurs, where the bigger star moves behind the smaller one, then we expect to see a great dip. These types of binary stars are called an eclipsing binary, due to the way of how the brightness of either stars affect the system's total brightness. Just a quick clarification, it's not necessary that the two eclipsing stars are uneven in size. This is just to exaggerate the example. The important part in categorizing a star to be eclipsing is that we can observe a dip in the brightness to supplement the data. Algol or Beta Persei is an example of this kind of binary. Okay, now that that's been steadied into place, we move on to the next example. Besides the brightness of a star, we can also take advantage of the spectra of light that it emits as it moves into its orbit. General relativity explains that since light is a wave, a moving light source is also bound to the Doppler effect. Specifically speaking, in the case of stellar objects, a star moving towards the Earth tends to have a frequency moving towards the blue spectrum, while the star moving in the opposite manner will have a frequency moving towards the red side. This is more commonly known as a redshift, and binary stars determined using this way are called spectroscopic binaries. The stars Sirius and Cygnus X1 belong to this category. There are also stars which redshift, are difficult to observe, or are completely unobservable. However, if we use spectroscopy, we are bound to see a combination of spectral change depending on the motion of the stars in the binary. If one star is moving away, we're bound to observe the spectral emission to shift closer to red. If the other is moving towards us, it shifts towards blue. These binaries are called spectrum binaries. Human ingenuity is really awesome, isn't it? Are you getting closer to guessing what the almost binary star is? We surely hope so. The next category is a bit controversial. It covers what happens to binary stars once they get too close that they essentially develop into a parasitic relationship. These stars are called contact binaries due to the fact that they are so close to one another that they are practically in contact, as the name goes, all the time. Let's illustrate this to help us understand better. Imagine a binary star system forms somewhere in the outer reaches of our Milky Way galaxy, to an imaginary nebula. Now, both of these stars are born in the same place, but for the sake of example, let's say the first one evolves to be simple, native, red dwarf, while the other takes a lot of nutrients from the particles around that it becomes a blue giant. Like all binaries, these two rotate about a common center at a constant. Following so far? Okay, great. The smaller star doesn't really do anything so exciting. It practically just stays there and burns all its hydrogen and helium at a steady slow rate. However, the bigger brother has a different story. Since it's bigger and more massive and therefore more energetic, it fuses its elements more rapidly and as a consequence, it blows up its excessive energy and loses mass. What happens to the mass being lost? Well, the smaller one takes it in and now begins to swell up into a more massive star, while the other one shrinks smaller and smaller. So what happens next? Well, there are various endings to the story of this binary star. It could get to as simple as the process repeating all over, where the now smaller one absorbs from the current bigger one up to a massive and explosive supernova or a star death. Now that we're done talking about the types of binary stars, are we ready for the big reveal? Let's see if our guesses match, shall we? The star that was almost a binary is, surprise, surprise, our very own sun. Back in the 1980s, scientists inferred the possibility of a second star that may have formed in the same protoplanetary disk in our own solar system that they aptly named Nemesis. They speculated that this might either be a brown dwarf, dim red dwarf, or even a white dwarf. Some geologists even dared to hypothesize that this could have caused several mass extinctions to our planet Earth. However, the search mission still continues this very day. And the searching has been long and difficult and full of conflict, since there are a lot of debates that have been going on due to the true nature or even simply the mere validity of the hypothesis. There's even a theory that says that the proud king of the solar system, Jupiter, may have been a failed star, which again connects to the possibility of the Sun being a binary system. All of these theories sound really absurd, but a lot of current theories once were like this. Remember how Copernicus used to be the crazy one and Ptolemy's heliocentric theory was more revered? Well, look at where we are now. Maybe someday we'll find Sun's long-lost twin, and maybe even say hi. We just have to keep looking. Like the twin suns of Tatooine, we should also set the suns of this episode and wrap it up with a question for you. Do you think life as we currently know it on Earth would have survived if our sun was a binary star? Would life have evolved differently? We'd love to read your answers in the comment section below. It's nice to see a lot of ideas come up and clash with one another. If you love this episode, don't forget to leave a like. We also make an episode every day, so don't forget to subscribe and hit that bell button so that you don't miss anything we put up. Thanks a lot for watching. Stay insanely curious.